can I welcome you to our online service for the Presbyterian congregations in Isle Magee and Ballyclare. And wherever you are clicking in from, I trust that as you join with us, you are encouraged and built up in your faith. Sunday, the 6th of September, is a really encouraging day. As for both our church families, it means a return to worshipping together. In Isle Magee, we are having a trial service before beginning officially on the 13th. And in Ballyclare, they're having their first service today. It has been a long journey for our church families. Over these last 6 months, we have journeyed, but we are looking forward in the coming weeks to worshiping with our church families. We will, of course, be continuing our online services for the foreseeable future, as there will be many for whom the return to worshiping together is not feasible for them at this time. The return to church will see an evolving of what the online service looks like as we seek to connect with our online viewers with what has happened in our church buildings. And so can I ask you and thank you for your patience through this transition. One of the great encouragements of being back physically together is that we have the opportunity to read God's word together. We will be doing that in our service today, and I would like you to join with me in reading a portion of scripture. Can I really encourage you to pick up your Bible, maybe flick to your Bible app. And so as we read aloud, the words will appear on the screen. We're going to be encouraged and reminded of the great God that we have come to worship today. So please read with me from Psalm 104 as we call ourselves to worship today. Psalm 104. Let all that I am praise the Lord. O Lord, my God, how great you are. You are robed with honor and majesty. You are dressed in a robe of light. You stretch out the starry curtain of the heavens. You lay out the rafters of your home in the rain clouds. You make the clouds your chariot. You ride upon the wings of the wind. The winds are your messengers. Flames of fire are your servants. You place the world on its foundation so it would never be moved. May the glory of the Lord continue forever. The Lord takes pleasure in all he has made. The earth trembles at his glance. The mountains smoke at his touch. I will sing to the Lord as long as I live. I will praise my God to my last breath. May all my thoughts be pleasing to him, for I rejoice in the Lord. Let all that I am praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Let's sing together the splendor of the King and O Lord my God.
Trembles.
maybe had a conversation with someone recently in which you reflected back over lockdown and what you might now appreciate more than you used to because of that experience. That could well have been an appreciation for family, the creation around us, peace and quiet, or a slower pace to life. My prayer for all of us is that we might also now have a greater appreciation for the church families that we were not able to worship together with. Wouldn't it be great, as we move forward together in the coming weeks and months, that we would all, from those who are not able to come to those who can, that we would all see the amazing gift that God has given us, which is His church, God's people. I want to use a prayer written for this time in the life of our denomination that focuses on these themes. Let's pray together. Lord of the church, what a gift you have given us in the body of Christ, in living stones locally assembled to be a spiritual house. Sometimes I haven't seen my congregation that way, as I have grumbled and complained about my spiritual family, selfishly look to my own needs before the interests of others, and carelessly neglected my need to meet with brothers and sisters for their encouragement and mine. Now I see things more clearly, valuing little things like the chat before or after worship that reminds me that someone else cares, cherishing the opportunity to raise my voice with others in praise of God, even if they or I am a little out of tune. Gaining a new sense of awe for the word of God preached and the way it challenges and encourages my everyday walk with Jesus. Setting much more store in your invitation to ask, to seek, and knock in prayer. Now that we have seen you give, found you answering, and known doors opened during the period of pandemic, life under lockdown. Help me not to lose this newfound appreciation for the community of my church as things begin to return to normal. Help me not to take for granted those who lead and serve, but to pray for and support them as they labour in the Lord, listening, learning, and lending a hand where I can. Help me to express a fresh commitment to the life of my church and its living witness to Jesus, experienced in those ways that show we belong to Him and to one another. Chosen and precious cornerstone, thank you for the people of your choosing that make up my congregation, built together as one, a holy nation of fellow travelers, your special possession, called out of darkness to bear your light. In Jesus' name, amen. Boys and girls, I am so glad that you've joined us as a church family here in Ballyclare today. I hope that your first week back to school has gone smoothly, that you are adjusting maybe to a new school, maybe a new teacher, or maybe new classmates. As we come back to worshiping together, I hope that no matter what age you are, that you know that you are an important part of our church family. For the next few weeks, there won't be any shine. You're going to be staying in church, and this might be a little bit new, but I hope that it will be a good experience as you get a little glimpse of what happens when you usually head out of church. I hope that you have received your worksheet pack, which you can begin after I sign off, and continue to learn from the Bible today. For the next few weeks, we are going to be looking at some verses from Ephesians chapter 6. And these verses speak about something called the armour of God. And today we are introducing that theme, and in a few moments going to watch a video that gives us a summary. But before that, I want to show you a picture of me when I was a teenager. Now, I look pretty funny, don't I? When I was at school, I was a hockey goalkeeper, and I had to put on all this protective gear so that when I was in the game and someone hit the hockey ball towards the net, I wouldn't get hurt when I made the save. And when I was practicing, I would often face lots and lots of hockey balls flying towards me all at the same time. I needed the protection, or I would get hurt. And if I got hurt, I might decide that I didn't enjoy playing hockey anymore and decide to stop. If we are following Jesus, the devil doesn't want us to. He's out to try and stop us and will be attacking us with his lies, trying to lead us away from Jesus. And just like I needed the goalkeeper gear to protect me in hockey, we need to put on God's armour that we read about in Ephesians chapter 6 to protect us. Our memory verse for today is Ephesians 6 verse 13. It goes like this. Therefore, put on every piece of God's armour, so you will be able to resist the enemy in the time of evil. Then, after the battle, you will still be standing firm. Over these next few weeks, we want you and all the adults to think about how you can put on every piece of God's armour as we follow Jesus. Let's watch a summary of the armour of God before next week we delve in a little deeper.
God's story, the armour of God. So part of God's story is about how God gives us armour, and it goes like this. When we follow Jesus, we're a part of God's kingdom. And one day, Jesus will recreate a perfect world for the whole family to enjoy with God forever. But until then, we're in a battle, which means we're part of God's family and his army. See, God's enemy, we call him the devil or Satan, has a kingdom too. And he has his own army devoted to tricking us into believing that we can't trust God, or that God doesn't really love us, or worse, that God's love isn't good enough. Basically, he'll do anything to get us to stop trusting and obeying God. He pretends to be sneaky, like in the Garden of Eden, when he tricked Adam and Eve into trusting him instead of God. But he really wants to destroy us. In fact, the Bible says he is like a roaring lion, looking for people to devour. Yikes! Kids, how would you feel if you were being chased by a roaring lion? Anyway, the good news is, God has given us armor to defend against all of the devil's attacks. And if you're going to be in a battle, you've got to have the right equipment. So the first thing we put on is a belt of truth. That's because Satan is the father of lies. But when we choose to believe the truth that Jesus rescued us and God loves us, it's like we're wearing devil repellent, so the devil's lies can't get through to us. We also get a breastplate of righteousness. Being righteous means always making right choices. Of course, nobody has done that except Jesus. But see, Jesus took the punishment for our bad choices. So when we choose to accept his rescue, God sees our sins as gone, which means to him, we are righteous. Satan means the accuser, and he loves to make us feel guilty. But we can defend ourselves by remembering how God sees us. Then come your feet. God covers them with what we need to go and tell people the good news about Jesus, kind of like boots. When more and more people believe in Jesus, the devil can't stand it because God's army and his kingdom are both getting bigger. We don't go into battle empty-handed either. We get a shield and a sword. Our shield is faith to block the devil's lies. Worried God won't take care of you? Nope. God promises to give us what we need. Worried God doesn't really love you? Nope. God created you in his own image. Our sword is the Word of God, or the Bible. Finally, we get a helmet of salvation, which helps us remember in our heads that Jesus rescued us. We are a part of God's family, and nothing can separate us from his love. That's right, nothing. And the best part? We're on the side that wins! So no matter how hard the devil tries to drag us over to his side, he won't be able to. God helps us stand strong and gives us armor we can use in the fight. And that's the story of the armor of God.
Let me pray for you as you continue in your service, and I look forward to seeing you at the end of the month. Let's pray together. Father God, we thank you for your amazing love for us. And we see that so clearly in the life and death of Jesus. And as we are reminded of your love, that gives us courage and strength when we face challenges or difficulties as we follow Jesus. In those difficult times, help us to know that you are with us every step of the way. Help us all to learn more about the armor of God and how we can put it on in our lives, and how that can keep us safe as we follow Jesus. Be with us all this week in school, with our families and with our friends. Help us to know you with us, that we never need to be afraid. And we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. To the church family in Ballyclare, I hope that you are well. We return to church today, and I encourage you that if you are able and willing to join with your church family next week, please do so. The service will be led by Tom Pollock, and you'll be really welcome at 11 a.m. I trust that you've received the letter detailing all the information that is needed, but if not, don't hesitate to contact Michelle. Today, I also have to inform you of the death of one of our members, Ethna Lorimer. She was the wife of Edwin Lorimer, a former clerk of session. Can I ask that you remember Ethna's family, her son Ian and daughter Alison? Pray that they and the entire family circle and friends might know God's peace and comfort as they mourn. Over the coming weeks, it is hoped to begin passing out some weekly announcements via email. And so if you haven't done so already and would like to receive these, please email the office and pass on your email address. Thank you for that. As schools return, as we return to worshiping together, as we have maybe ventured out to eat during August, there's maybe the feeling that those initial months of lockdown are in the past. I think we all know that we need to continue to be sensible and take precautions. As we return to worshiping together, we do so observing social distancing, sanitizing our hands, wearing face coverings. But we do hope that we are through the worst. I wonder, in these last few weeks, have you taken any time to reflect on the journey you have had through this initial stage of the pandemic? What comes to your mind as you reflect on those months of lockdown through spring? Each of us have had a very individual one, depending on our own unique circumstances. But there has been no doubt that as we listened to the daily briefings on TV from the government, we were confronted with the reality of life and death. In a few moments, I want us to pause from our busyness and reflect, mindful of God's presence with us, and reflect as we listen to the hymn, Christ Our Hope in Life and Death. An online description of the hymn goes like this. What is your only comfort in life and in death? For centuries, believers have learned the Christian faith, beginning with that question. It's the first article in the Heidelberg Catechism of 1563. But why start there? Because death is our common fate. Unless Jesus returns first, we will all die. To find comfort in life, we must know how we can face death. And hope comes only in trusting the one who died to take the curse of death and who crushed the power of death by his resurrection. Christ has been raised from the dead, as we find in 1 Corinthians 15. And that is the only statement that can transform how we live each day and how we prepare for our earthly life to end. The hope of the resurrection spurs us to sing. And that's why a group of songwriters from Getty Music wrote the modern hymn, Christ, Our Hope in Life and Death. And like the Heidelberg Catechism that inspired it, this song is honest about death. There's no need to shrink back from mentioning death in our hymns, because we know the living one who has conquered death forever. The Christian can sing hallelujah because Christ assures us of our glorious future. Now and ever we confess, I am not my own, but belong body and soul in life and in death to my faithful Saviour, Jesus Christ. The words and tune of this modern hymn were written months before any of us had heard of the coronavirus, and I believe God in his providence has used the timely release of this hymn to encourage his people during these last months. He has encouraged me, and I hope he will again now. I want to encourage you to take these few moments, maybe even close your eyes, listen to these words, reflect on these past months, and I pray draw close to God in thanksgiving, hope and peace. Christ, our hope in life and death.
Our hope in life and death, Christ alone, Christ alone. What is our only confidence that our souls to him belong? Who holds our days within his hand? What comes apart from his command? And what will us to the end, the love of Christ in which we stand. Oh, sing hallelujah, our hope springs eternal. Oh, sing hallelujah, now and ever we confess Christ our hope. God is good, God is good. Where is his grace and goodness known? In our great Redeemer's blood, who holds our faith when fears arise, who stands above the stormy trial, who sends the waves that bring us nigh unto the shore, the rock of Christ. Oh, sing hallelujah, our hope springs eternal. Oh, sing hallelujah, now Christ is ours forever.
Let us pray together. Father, in these last few moments, we have taken time to stop. And we are sorry that we are so often in such a rush that we miss the opportunity to pause, to reflect, and most of all, to remember and to see all that you've been doing in our lives. Father, over these last months, we thank you for your faithfulness in the midst of trial. We can speak of your grace to us in our own individual journeys, and we thank you for your presence along the way. Lord God, so often it is only when there is trial and challenge that we lean on you as we should. And we again say sorry and pray that you would give us the grace to trust in you day by day, step by step, in good times and tough times. We pray that you would help us keep in step with the Holy Spirit, that our lives would be marked by the fruit of love and joy, peace and patience, kindness and goodness, faithfulness and gentleness and self-control. This is your heart's desire for us, and we pray that we would join you in this endeavor. Father, we pause and again remind ourselves of the joy of being part of your family in our church family. We again confess that we don't always appreciate this gift, that our hearts are often too concerned about our own needs and preferences. And so, Father, we pray that over these coming weeks you would change our hearts as we pray for each other, using these words, this prayer found in Ephesians chapter 1. I keep asking that the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the glorious Father, may give you the spirit of wisdom and revelation so that you may know him better. I pray that the eyes of your heart may be enlightened in order that you may know the hope to which he has called you, the riches of his glorious inheritance in his holy people, and his incomparably great power for us who believe. Father, we pray for each other, that we may come to know you better as we worship together. And we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. As I was preparing for today and what I was going to preach from, I had some plans, which I have actually put on hold, because I was very timely reminded that before lockdown, I was in the middle of a sermon series in Revelation. And we're going to return to finish that series off over the coming weeks. The next passage and section that we're going to look at today couldn't have been more relevant. And we thank God for that. We're turning to Revelation 7. I hope that you might pick up your Bible, press your Bible app as we turn to hear God's word today. Revelation 7. Then I saw four angels standing at the four corners of the earth, holding back the four winds so they did not blow on the earth or the sea or even on any tree. And I saw another angel coming up from the east, carrying the seal of the living God.
And he shouted to those four angels who had been given power to harm land and sea. Wait. Don't harm the land or the sea or the trees until we have placed the seal of God on the foreheads of his servants. Then down to verse 9. After this, I saw a vast crowd, too great to count, from every nation and tribe and people and language, standing in front of the throne and before the Lamb. They were clothed in white robes and held palm branches in their hands, and they were shouting with a great roar, "Salvation comes from our God, who sits on the throne and from the Lamb." And all the angels were standing around the throne and around the elders and the four living beings. And they fell before the throne with their faces to the ground and worshipped God. They sang, "Amen. Blessing and glory and wisdom and thanksgiving and honor and power and strength belong to our God forever and ever. Amen." Then one of the 24 elders asked me, "Who are these who are clothed in white? Where did they come from?" And I said to him, "Sir, you are the one who knows." Then he said to me, "These are the ones who died in the great tribulation. They have washed their robes in the blood of the Lamb and made them white. That is why they stand in front of God's throne and serve him day and night in his temple. And he who sits on the throne will give them shelter. They will never again be hungry or thirsty. They will never be scorched by the heat of the sun. For the Lamb on the throne will be their shepherd. He will lead them to springs of life-giving water. And God will wipe every tear from their eyes."
Some people living in large cities may find it a challenge to escape from the busyness, the noise and pollution, and to find an oasis of calm and quiet that doesn't involve traveling many, many miles out of the city into the countryside. I remember watching a movie that showed a private, high-fenced park in the midst of a large, busy city, which at the beginning of the movie, I believe, was out of bounds to one of the leading characters. But of course, as with any good story, it finished with him together relaxing in the arms of the leading lady in the midst of that private, high-fenced park. An oasis of grass and flowers and trees and peace and quiet. That private park was in great contrast to all that was around it in the hustle and bustle of the city. What we find here in Revelation 7 is in huge contrast to the chapters around it. It is an oasis of encouragement to God's people, found in the midst of chapters that speak of the chaos of history. If we had more time, we could read of the portrayal of the horrors of the first century. But those horrors were not exclusive to that time. The chaos that we read of in chapter 6, external conquest, internal conflict, famine, widespread death, well, that can be seen if we were to read through a history of the 20th century and every century before it. There has been and continues to be a turmoil of history, which at times may seem surreal as we live here in relative peace and quiet, whether in Isle Magee or Ballyclare. However, even a section of our history of our own province in the last 50 years also fits the same bill. It's interesting, coming to these verses after the circumstances of the last 6 months,
The COVID-19 global pandemic will certainly go down into the history books. It'll be one of those things that we can tell the next generation that we lived through. And it fits with the turmoil of history that we see in these surrounding chapters. And that means, as we come to chapter 7 today, having experienced something of that turmoil, these verses can speak with even more encouragement, even more challenge, than they may have done even 8 months ago. I'm sure there have been times in your life when you have wished you had possession of a freeze time button. The kids are going mad around you. The volume is at max. Your blood pressure is rising. You wish you could just press pause and sit down for 5 minutes. It has been one of those days at work. Non-stop since you got there, everyone demanding something, not getting time to do what really needs done. You wish you could press pause. Grab a cuppa. Get your head around what really needs to get done. You have a big decision to make by 4 p.m. You don't know what to do. You've got some advice, but it doesn't seem to have really helped. You wish you could press the pause button to just give you a little more time. Here in chapter 7, it is as if a pause button has been pressed. The action from chapter 6 that has been paused because God has a very important picture to paint. A picture of his work among his people for their good, for their security. God's people are being sealed. The opening 4 verses set the context. There are 4 angels standing at the 4 corners of the earth. And these angels have been given power to harm land and sea. And yet here, they are holding back the 4 winds that would bring that destruction. They are waiting for something to happen. We discover what they are waiting for in verse 3. We read this. Do not harm the land or the sea or the trees until we put a seal on the foreheads of the servants of our God. God's people are being sealed. We have to be careful as we read these verses to see what is being said. Verse 3 is not a one-off event, but this sealing takes place through the mission of the church down through the centuries as people respond to the good news of Jesus. Amongst the turmoil of history, the good news is preached, and as people respond, they are sealed with the Holy Spirit. They will be brought to safety through the chaos to experience what we find later in chapter 7. There are a number of times through the New Testament that we read of the sealing. And I think it would be helpful for us to read each of these verses. Firstly, from Ephesians 1, we read this, verse 13. When you believed, you were marked in him with a seal, the promised Holy Spirit, who is the deposit guaranteeing our inheritance until the redemption of those who are God's possession to the praise of his glory. And then in Ephesians 4, verse 30, and do not grieve the Holy Spirit of God, with whom you were sealed for the day of redemption. In 2 Corinthians 1, verse 21, we read this. Now it is God who makes both us and you stand firm in Christ. He anointed us, set his seal of ownership on us, and put his Spirit in our hearts as a deposit, guaranteeing what is to come. And then later in chapter 5, verse 5, now the one who has fashioned us for this very purpose is God, who has given us the Spirit as a deposit, guaranteeing what is to come. As the chaos and turmoil take place around us, whatever that might be, down through the centuries, even in 2020, God's people are safe and secure, sealed by God's Spirit, guaranteeing our inheritance, guaranteeing life with Jesus. In spiritual terms, as we trust in Jesus' death, we are sealed and safe. Nothing this world can throw at us will separate us from God's love that we find in Jesus. No matter what the chaos or turmoil, our destiny is sure. And the surrounding chapters speak of martyrs for their faith, and so the physical turmoil may even take our life. But as we were just reflecting, our hope in life and death is Jesus. Whether we live or if we die, as we trust in Jesus, God has set his seal of ownership on us. We are his. And surely this amazing truth can transform how we face the turmoil and chaos of a broken world. It is the ability to cast out fear. And naturally we can experience fear as we face the uncertainty of the future. And yet this truth reminds us that we are safe and secure no matter what. We shouldn't be surprised by this chaos that has continued down through the centuries, but should instead live a spiritual wartime lifestyle. Always ready to face the battle. Always ready to bring hope and light through Jesus into that darkness. Not complacent as in peacetime, but at a state of readiness to love and to care, to be the hands and feet of Christ. And this truth should transform our whole life worship as we acknowledge that God will bring us through no matter what, that through Christ we can know hope and peace and contentment and purpose despite the chaos that we are living through. We can know life to the full in the praise of God. As we gather to worship, these verses remind us of the foretaste of worship that we will experience in heaven. Verses 9 and 10 are quite the picture. A multicultural, multinational gathering of God's people before the throne, praising God, praising the Lamb, Jesus Christ. And the number of this multitude that we find described in verses 4 to 8 that we didn't read is that of 144,000, a symbolic number used here to emphasize fullness and completeness, the full number of God brought to safety. And our response to the safety and security that we can know through the Holy Spirit is to follow day by day in the footsteps of that multitude who praise God, as we find in verse 12. Verse 14 reminds us again of the seal upon our lives. As we trust in Jesus, these are they who have come out of the great tribulation. God has brought them through to experience the wonder of the closing verses of this chapter. And there are verses that echo the well-known verses of Revelation 21. There is escape from the chaos of the world. He who sits on the throne will shelter them with his presence. Never again will they hunger. Never again will they thirst. God will wipe away every tear from their eyes. This is our hope that can give us the courage and strength to remain faithful through the chaos. This world is not the end. We are only passing through. Heaven is our inheritance. I find God to be gracious beyond belief through his involvement in our lives. Throughout these last number of months, as we have pulled together online services, and particularly maybe when I've been on holiday and involved others, those involved have witnessed God bringing together common themes through connections, through prayers and readings and sermons in ways that only he could. And God is reminding us that he is graciously at work among us. And once more today, God, through different passages of the Bible that I didn't choose deliberately and last week didn't even know I was going to choose, is reinforcing what should be most important in each of our lives. Last week, we were looking at Luke 24. And through the interactions of Jesus and the penitent criminal, we were reminded that being with Jesus is what makes heaven paradise. Life in the here and now, life eternal, it's all about Jesus. And here in Revelation 7, as we look towards heaven, we read this in verse 17. For the Lamb at the center of the throne will be their shepherd. He will lead them to springs of living water. Again, being with Jesus is what makes heaven paradise. Jesus is our shepherd. Jesus is the source of living water, of life eternal. And in these changed days, in these uncertain days, our families, our workplaces, our communities, our world need those who treasure Jesus above everything else. As people search for hope, as people search for answers, God calls us to be light in the darkness. And we do that by claiming these words that I'm about to say, living out these words that I'm about to say. I rejoice in my Redeemer, greatest treasure, wellspring of my soul. I will trust in him, no other. My soul is satisfied in him alone. May God graciously move in us so that this is a description of you and a description of me. Amen.
Oh Lord, my rock and my Redeemer, greatest treasure of my longing soul. My God, like you there is no other. True delight is found in you alone. Your grace, a well too deep to fathom. Your love exceeds the heaven's reach. Your truth, a fount of perfect wisdom, my highest good and my unending need. Oh Lord, my rock and my Redeemer, strong defender of my weary heart. My sword to fight the cruel deceiver, and my shield against his hateful darts. My song when enemies surround me, my hope when tides of sorrow rise, my joy when trials are abounding, your faithfulness, my refuge in the night. And my Redeemer, gracious Savior of my ruined life, my guilt and cross laid on your shoulders, Lord bled and died. You rose, the grave and death are conquered. You broke my bonds of sin and shame. You rose, the grave and death are conquered. You broke my bonds of sin and shame. Oh Lord, my rock and my redeemer, may all my days bring glory to your name. May all my days bring glory to your name.
Can I thank you for joining with us today? And as we close, I want to encourage you as I pray some verses from the New Testament book of Jude. The book closes with these words that speak of our assurance, our security in the hands of God. So let me pray and commit you to the God who is able to keep you from stumbling and to present you before his glorious presence without fault and with great joy. To the only God, our Saviour, be glory, majesty, power, and authority through Jesus Christ, our Lord.